You're next in line for the official Holiday World Podcast.
Welcome to Holiday World and Splash and Safari.
Dropping in from Santa Claus, Indiana.
Riders will experience swift acceleration, high-speed turns, and sudden stops.
With park president and CEO, Matt Eckert.
That's a lot of wasted time.
Fourth-generation owners, Lauren Crosby.
We have to laugh through the pain.
And Leah Cook.
The claws come out.
Director of Attractions, Eric Retz.
How do you think we feel, lady?
And Director of Communications, Paula Wernie.
I shovel other things, man.
Yes, you do.
Now stow your loose articles, buckle up,
and please keep your hands and legs inside the car at all times.
And we are back. Welcome back to the official Holiday World Podcast. This is podcast episode 052. Today's date is Friday, February 16th, 2018. And the title of today's episode is The One with the Drone Man.
Dun, dun, dun.
All I can hear is, da, 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 I'm a drone man. Yeah. Right?
Okay.
That's been going through my head all week.
Oh, no.
Well, it's going through my head now, but it wasn't.
I was going to say, now that it's in my head.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. Soul Man, you did recognize what I was
I did.
Badly
saying. What you were trying to
right?
do.
Yeah. All right. Our guest today is usually on the other side of the microphone, our digital media developer and drone man. Yeah. Stephen Rutherford, welcome.
Thank you for having me.
Like don't be polite. You got to do the drone man.
NPR voice.
I feel like drone man should be on his name tag now instead of digital media developer. Like drone man sounds cooler.
Drone man.
AKA.
The drone man. We wanted to have Stephen come get on this side of the microphone for this episode to talk to us about the story of the holodrone, which was a long, sometimes sad, sometimes disappointing,
you know,
sometimes joyous.
I think we could actually sell that to Lifetime, and it would probably be better than the snowed in Christmas that was shown. It was quite the saga.
But I remember when you were here for your interview and when we ultimately hired you, which was almost 4 years ago. Has it really been that long already?
Three and a half years.
And I remember sitting in the conference room and I mentioned, oh, and we have a drone. And his eyes lit up like it was Christmas morning. It was like, a drone. I really want a drone. And then why don't you pick up the story from there? So then we hired you under basically false pretense. Because
under the auspices that there was a drone to be flown. And at the time, Eric Snow was the one who was kind of the keeper of the drone. And I remember my first day of work was Rock the World in 2014. And for those who may not understand Rock the World history, that was the year that everyone was holed up because the weather was horrible and it was raining and people were singing inside of Plymouth Rock Cafe and there was nothing but mud everywhere. And
it was a great day.
I just remember I was like, I just bought these white shoes today and now they are fully brown. It was quite
actually Stephen in my heart forever when we were finally done and we'd all hopped in my vehicle to go back up to the office at whatever 11 o'clock at night. And he was like, I don't want to get your car muddy. And it's like, it's fine. We'll clean it up later. And all of us were just filthy and especially Stephen, because he'd been crawling all over the place. And he said, oh, don't worry about my shoes. He said he has five children, as we all know. He said, whichever one bugs me the most tomorrow, we'll clean them. I think I love you, Stephen. Yeah. That was great.
So I just remember Eric was flying the drone, during Mandisa, Toby back and all of that. And I remember going up to him and I was just like, wow, this is so cool. You got to teach me how to do this. And so that kind of started me on the track to learning about the drone. And so I learned a little more about it over the next couple of weeks. And lo and behold, the FAA decided just a couple months after I started that they were going to put a clamp down on the rules of what it was to be a drone operator, especially a commercial drone operator. And so
in mind, we had just announced that we were building a $22 million B&M steel coaster.
And most of my training for the drone was flying around the construction site and getting these really cool looks of a not yet complete track. And it was heartbreaking when we were grounded from that. So fast forward a couple of years And we finally get to the point where, I mean, this drone, for the people who are interested, it was a Phantom 1. And we had had it for a while before I got here, but it was just sitting on our shelf. I mean, it was just collecting dust. And we finally got to the point where we said, you know what? We can get rid of this. The FAA is not going to come out with any rules anytime soon. They're nowhere near being able to actually, you know, come to an agreement on what a drone operator should be. You could probably tell by the dripping disdain in my last statement that probably 3 weeks, I would say, after we relinquished our initial drone, the FAA came out with what was called the Part 107 rules, which for a government entity were probably some of the most level-headed regulations that you could have actually had for something. And I just remember going into Paula's office and just like shaking my head and dropping it into my hands like, we don't have a drone anymore, but now we have drone laws. It's like, can we ask for it back?
I guess we donated it to your church. So yeah. It's probably not the smartest thing to, can we have that back, please? But we got it in the budget for the next year.
We did. Yeah. Thankfully there's capital expenditures and we were able to get that approved for the next year.
And so last spring you were back to school studying.
I was, there were a lot of rules to learn, for the Part 107. Like I said, they were the most level headed rules that I've seen come out of a government organization in quite some time. But, at the same time, you had to know them all, because there's a test and you have to pass the test or you don't get your commercial operator's license.
And you have to have a commercial license because you would be shooting footage for a business that would be using it for marketing purposes. There are hobbyists and then there are those who do it for commercial purposes. And the rules are very, very different.
Yeah. Right. And to be fair, the hobbyists are supposed to adhere to the Part 107 rules. But a lot of them just buy it off
take
of eBay
it out of the box
and just, you know, send it up into the stratosphere.
Nice.
So, but as long as they're not getting paid
by the
for
way,
it.
Leah Cook is with us. Oh, I just say nice and said. It's like, oh, yeah, we got so into our drone man.
I'm into the drone story.
We have the purple haired Leah Cook. Yes. I will take a picture. Would you explain your hair and we'll get right back to the drone.
So the MBA program has a gala tomorrow night and the theme is Once Upon a Time. So I've decided I'm dressing like a villain. And so I've dyed my hair kind of a ridiculous color for fun.
So what villain? Just a general
just
villain?
Kind of a general specific? Villain, yeah.
Okay.
No one specific, but...
Cool. Well, it's very
gonna do some
very
intense
purple.
Makeup and got a black dress. It's going to be fun.
Will you send us a picture?
Yes.
Okay. We'll share that. But Mr. Rentz actually is not with us today. He's actually, I said, of all the times to start being a grown up, he's actually attending a meeting that James asked him to attend this morning. So he had to duck out. So luckily Leah was available to run down from IU and join us. Okay. Back to the drone man story. So you were studying. I remember you studied like mad, took it very seriously, and then had your appointment in Louisville, Kentucky to take your test.
Yeah. You actually have to take the test. It's interesting because there are other private pilots. I won't give them away. In the area that's where they had to take their test to actually fly an airplane. And so you actually have to go to a certified FAA testing center to take your test.
Did they make you abide by like LSAT rules? You have to leave your cell phone in your car.
Oh yeah.
You have to like, you can take a plastic bag in of things that you need, like pencils, erasers, that.
I couldn't even take a pencil.
Oh my gosh, you can't even bring your own pencil. That's a comfort thing for me.
I'm so curious about my pencils.
That's a big issue for me.
I have a hard time with that.
I was allowed to bring two things into that room, a calculator and a magnifying glass. That was the only two things I was able to bring in.
Wow.
They provided me scratch paper. They provided me a ruler and a compass. They provided me two pencils.
And
were
lots
very
of warnings.
Stern,
yeah.
Yes, and their warnings. Had to leave my watch, my phone, everything, like any electronic device. Mm-hmm. I had to leave with the proctor. And
they made us leave it in the car.
Yeah. Well,
I felt super insecure about that because I was just like, I'm just saying, if somebody knew that the LSAT was going on, I'd go start breaking into cars. Yeah. I mean, I'm just saying.
But that's what I do in
my spare time. Now that you have purple hair, that's what you'll be doing.
I break into cars now. It's a thing.
Noted.
Okay.
If I slip out for a second, don't worry about it.
Josh, can you make sure my car is locked? when I went in, first of all, it was an active hangar as well. So there were private planes and stuff just on the other side of the wall. So they were saying, you're going to hear it. It's an operational airport. So you're going to hear airport noises. There are going to be engines firing up and all that kind of stuff. Which is, it's a whole lot louder when you have to sit in silence and do all this. But when you sat down, you were in a cubicle and he's running through all these things. There's a webcam up there so the proctor can watch you to make sure that you're not cheating.
How would you cheat?
Right. And then he even said that there
you write things on your arm.
We got the.
The German exchange students in high school taught us all kinds of things because one of the female students suggested that you write something on the inside of your leg and wear a skirt because then no one can ask you to. That is such a terrible idea. Jeez. Effective, but
how about
terrible.
Maybe just study.
Yeah. Listeners, don't do that.
Yes. Don't do that.
So I feel like we need to have a warning.
But the German exchange students in high
cheating
school
is
taught
not
me.
Okay.
They taught me all of this stuff. I'm like, so I know all the best strategies. I've never used them.
I want to be very clear.
I see now why you're going as a villain. It fits. Yeah.
I like to collect that knowledge. I don't actually use it.
It's not actionable.
I'm honest. Right.
We believe that.
Oh, that's great. But one of the warnings that he gave me is he said, okay, someone else is scheduled to come in after you, about an hour after you. It's like, when they come in, I'm going to give them all the same spiel. You may not look up. You may not converse with them. If they sneeze, you may not so much as say, God bless you. If you do, both of your tests are invalidated. You will have to come back another time and take the test and pay again because we had to pay to take the test.
So just because somebody sneezed, you could totally screw them over?
Yes.
Wow.
Yes. It was intense.
I feel like you need to take your allergy medicine that day.
He was nervous. I don't think you were nervous about taking the test.
I think the conditions of testing for some of that stuff is more intense.
Planes taking off and people sneezing. And
I don't think that would make me do worse if I was so tense and nervous all the time that I might do something.
No comfort pencil?
Yeah.
Government. It's gone too far. People.
Yeah, it has all of my bite marks on it.
Can't even sniffle.
But yeah, that was pretty intense, and you got nervous really quick.
No kidding.
Did you ever do anything during the test and think, oh gosh, I should have done that, I'm going to get in trouble?
No, because I was too afraid to, and I knew they were watching me from the webcam.
I would have done something and got myself in trouble. I would have winked or something.
Yeah.
Or you flipped them. Yeah. I don't do that.
Well, being is that I was doing this as a part of Holiday World. Holiday World was paying for the test, and I really didn't want to do anything to screw it up and say, hey, guess what?
But he came back and was all smiles, and passed.
Yes, I passed it the first time. You had to get a 70% or above to pass.
Is it like the BMV where you find out right away?
Yeah.
It automatically goes off once you either pass or fail.
Yeah. So
they send a plane off if you win.
That would be awesome.
Shooting star. But yeah, I got an 88%, which wasn't the best. It was a B+, but you know, I still passed. And I even asked the proctor, like, can I know what I missed? And he was just like, it doesn't matter. You passed. And I was like, well, no, I really, I'd like to know what I missed. That's the kind of student that I was. I always wanted to know what I missed so that I could improve. And he was just like, don't bother. You passed. Just do better in 2 years because I've got to take it again every two years.
So you're going to stress out about it next time too?
But what if you had something wrong that was like really important?
I was
going
to say, what if it's a thing that you're going to get fined for at a different time?
That's one of the reasons that I was asking. But I think most of it, because we had to know, we actually had to learn what are called sectional charts. And they're basically, think about Google Maps when you're just seeing like roads and stuff like that.
Right.
But you have all of the airports have all of their airspace that's designated, and there's different classes of airspace and where the ceilings and the floors are, where all the planes are supposed to be. And you're just supposed to know all of this stuff because by and large, most people are going to be in metropolitan areas wanting to fly. Right. They just don't want you to get in the way of a commercial airliner because they're traveling at, you know, hundreds of miles an hour. You see what can happen when they hit birds, if anybody just remember Sully in the Hudson, you know. Yeah. So
a bird can mess you up. I'm sure a drone can too.
Yeah. Of course, they're plastic and they kind of fall apart, but you don't want to test those waters.
Yeah.
but yeah, we had to learn all of that. We had to learn all this stuff about weather. I'm pretty sure most of the stuff that I missed was all meteorological. I know because I'm getting older and my joints hurt when it rains, and that's pretty much all I know about weather. but yeah, it was very interesting, like when fog forms and there's different kinds of fog and what the fog does here and there and what happens when different types of clouds form and when does it become, you know, when does a thunderstorm reach maturity and all these other kind of things. It's very interesting.
That's very specific.
That makes me think of our like storm certification class that we took.
I know. Right. We didn't go that deep.
Certain things and like wall clouds and things like that. And I looked at a lot of the pictures and was like, they look like clouds.
They look like clouds.
They look like clouds. This is not a thing I can care about. Yeah.
Like,
I would never be the storm spotter at the park. It's fine.
So it's one of the things that, I mean, it makes sense to me now, but the prefix suffix nimbus actually means rain. So if you've got cumulus.
Why did no one ever tell me that?
Yeah. So you have cumulus clouds and they're, you know, but then a cumulonimbus cloud means that it's a cumulus cloud with rain in it.
Oh.
And so you're.
That makes me so angry.
I see a storm cloud right in this room.
I know. Kind of hovering right over here above the purple hair.
Oh, so you passed and we were very excited. Yay. We did a dance of joy and then you got to work on a SOP, a standard operating procedure that was very interesting. That what I like about it is we took it so seriously. We took it beyond what the federal government insists upon.
Nice.
And have extra layers of safety. So take us through, Stephen, when you wanted to go get footage of the mammoth last summer, how far in advance did you start the planning for that?
Well, thinking about the SOP, it's very interesting that, you know, we take all of the rules of the FAA, and that's our baseline. That's where we start. Then on top of that, because we're somewhat of a unique location, unique location.
You've been away too long.
Yeah. Because we're in sort of a unique location, i.e. there's always a lot of people around. One of the rules is that you're not supposed to fly over people. there's always people around. Plus, you know, we have these very large rides that go really fast. And there are certain safety zones and boundaries, you know, clearance envelopes and everything else that you need to stay outside of. And so we were looking at it and we said, okay, there are certain things that we will do and we will never do. And so we started putting those in writing and little things like, I will never fly the drone over an open ride track. I will go over tunnels, but I will never go over an open ride track. Why? What if the battery dies? It becomes a rock. It then becomes a hazard on the ride track. Not going to happen. So if I ever was to fly into the infield of a ride, say the Legend, then I'm going to pick a spot where I can fly over a tunnel and I cause no hazard to the train or the guests below. Nice. Just little things like that. Again, say with Mammoth or Wildebeest, you have a lot of empty space under. I will fly under all day long because I'm not going to put anybody in danger. But you know, we were pretty serious and we looked at a lot of those sorts of things, how to keep myself safe, how to keep other people who were with me as VOs, as they call them, visual observers. And so we kind of looked at all of that and put that into a document. And as part of that, we created the catchy term, the three-legged stool of myself and Director of Attractions, Eric Rentz, and our Director of Safety and Security, John Adkins. And before I can even fly, I have to get the okay from the other two of them. So when I go and take footage of a mammoth, I have to start at least 2 days out. I'm looking at weather conditions to see what winds are doing, see if it's a nice, clear, sunny day. If it's not, then I try to look out further and see, okay, when are the clouds going to break? Because it's always better to see, you know, puffy clouds in the sky. I know, yeah. I just said puffy clouds, and I'm just saying that.
Was that on the test?
Cumulonimbus and all that. Yeah, big puffy clouds.
They should have called it that.
Yeah.
If they called it that, I might care a little bit more. I'm just saying, I might understand it.
It sounds more interesting.
Puffy clouds and rainbows, but then.
Hot candy clouds.
Yeah. Cotton candy. Yeah. That's great.
Cotton okay, balls. We're going to take over National Weather Service. We're going to rename all the clouds.
Do
don't worry about it. We'll let you know when
we'll
we're
let
done.
You know.
We have stormy.
Stormy clouds.
But
tornado-y clouds.
Big clouds.
Angry clouds.
Angry clouds.
Donut clouds.
I love that. Yesterday, I saw some very interesting clouds on my way to Evansville. They look more like cornrow clouds. It was very interesting.
Cornrow clouds. I like that. That was, great. Yeah. Another one.
Yeah.
I remember when we were doing our 66 days at sea teaser for before we announced Thunderbird, and every day we were looking at clouds and looking for cloud formations that might look actually like a Thunderbird. And I think I got one, and I think Eric Snow got one once,
yeah.
too. Yes. There were just amazing clouds. That. And it probably took me a good 6 months to stop looking
at clouds.
I got to take a picture
and just like, what's that one look like?
Everybody knows. So calm down.
but yeah, so once I look through the weather and all of that, I actually draw up a flight plan. And I send it out to Eric and to John. And the flight plan, I literally go to Google Earth and I say, this is the part of the park that I'm going. So say I'm going to go film Thunderbird. I will say, this is where I'm taking off from. I draw a little line that says, this is the path that I'm going to fly. I usually tell them about the altitude that I'm going to fly and what I'm actually, and I even have on there the drone and kind of a direction that it's going to be pointed so that they know what I'm going to be filming. Then they're able to come back to me with, most of the time it's, yeah, it looks great. Have a good flight. But there are some times that it's, you know, well, there's something going on here. You know, they're having to fix a part of an access road or something like that. You're going to need to be careful, or you need to, you know, not go that far, you know, find a mm-hmm. different place to take off, you know? So there's a little bit of push and pull. I'll redo the flight plan, send it back out. And they'll say, yeah, they haven't told me no yet. So, thankfully, the system I think that we have in place, I think we did it right because nice. We were very upfront with everybody, and there's a nice level of trust between everybody and respect for each other because we're trying to play by the rules mm-hmm. and not just the FAA's rules, but the rules that we put on ourselves. So
nice.
Yay.
Yeah.
So what would you say is your favorite drone footage to date, whether footage or still?
I'm so glad you asked. I brought some examples.
Oh my gosh.
One of the things that I absolutely love is looking at the water park. The water park has so many amazing colors, and with the trees all around, with it just nestled down in the little valley there, it's so cool. Thunderbird is also quite possibly the most picturesque roller coaster you could ever photograph. I mean, it's just, there's so many cool parts to it that it's, between the launch and its proximity to the Voyage and even kind of the kinetic energy when Crow's Nest is going, it's just, there's so much there, and with it nestled in the trees and just the colors, it's just everything. It's just really cool. So a lot of my favorites are that. I think probably the penultimate for me is
good word.
I was just going to say that I like that word.
Yeah.
Was when the New York Times came to do a story on Mammoth. We worked with them, and so I was flying the drone, and they were kind of giving direction as to what to do. And they said, I'd really like to just see a layout shot of the whole ride. Can you just go as high as you can, you know, as high as you're allowed to, and just look down at the ride? And I really hadn't thought about that because usually I'm wanting to see people's faces and all that kind of stuff. Being able to see the layout of the ride from almost 400 feet in the air was so cool that it almost looked like it was fake. Like it almost looked like it was
like a drawing or a rendering.
Like it was a rendering, like ProSlide had put together for us. And so it's just like, I brought those as just kind of still images, but that's probably like my favorite. And then, and the fact that we just hovered there, I probably hovered there for 2 or 3 minutes and just let, like I followed a boat through the entire ride cycle just to make sure that I saw the whole thing.
Right.
And it's just so cool. That's one of my favorites. And I know we post it on social media.
On Facebook, it gets so, it goes crazy.
People love it. And they're, for good reason.
It's mesmerizing. It's just, it is. Even though it's just, it's a static shot until you realize the boats are moving.
The boats are actually moving.
It's not a photo, it's a video.
Yeah.
And then you said you had a real bonding moment with going out there with Josh, our Ho-O-Coco.
Right.
And who's hopefully still down recording.
Yeah, hopefully he hasn't fallen asleep.
And,
he's given up on us.
He's out checking cars for cell phones.
Right. Trying to identify clouds.
And Foster, the intern. You said working with the two of them was great last summer.
Yeah, when Josh came in, we had already started the season last year. And it was kind of, it was a really neat time because we would all three go out. The system was kind of new and we just wanted to make sure we were doing everything correctly. Legally, I don't have to have a visual observer, but it's always good to have another set of eyes out there. Mm-hmm. So I always like to fly with at least one other person. And when we would go out and when it was still new, the three of us would go out and it was great because it kind of helped all three of us gel together. It was, you know, Josh coming in, you know, hitting the ground running, and then Foster, I was trying to get him up to speed on things as well. And he actually loved it so much. Foster got a drone for Christmas.
Really? Oh,
I love that.
Yeah. He sent me a picture on Christmas Day and he said, look what I got. And he's sitting there holding his drone. So he's got the bug too, but it was a really good bonding moment. And I think it really solidified us as a team. So
nice. And didn't somebody call out from riding the mammoths when they saw the drone?
Yeah. It was actually Wildebeest and Foster had the greatest response. We were filming, kind of the end of the first limb, on Wildebeest where you're like way up high and you're about to go into the tunnel. That's just a great shot because you can look out over the water park. You see Voyage over there on your left and you got Legend out there in front of you. It's just a neat park. You can a neat part of the park where you can see water park, dry park, and you see all this stuff together. And for those of you who have been on Wildebeest know that you're on a lift hill to get up to the top of it. And somebody saw us as we were standing there in the infield and looked over and said, hey, what's that drone doing? Foster did not even miss a beat. And he just turned around and said, it's flying. And he just turned around and just kept watching what he was doing. He was like, what do you think it's doing? It's flying.
Oh, Foster. Oh, Foster.
I really love the water park picture here.
Yeah, it's pretty.
I feel like we've never had an actual water park picture that includes Zimbabwe because generally we're taking those
we're taking
photos
the
from the tower.
From Zimbabwe because it's the tallest tower. Yeah,
that's a very good point.
Yeah,
as someone who's been a photography intern here.
Yep, you are correct, and it's just it's neat.
So
to
great
be able
to see
that.
All of it.
Yes. Yeah, it's, I love the colors. Like mm-hmm. There's something about the blue of the water, and then all the colors of the rides and stuff. It's mesmerizing.
And the green of the trees.
The green of the trees.
Which we currently don't have.
Right.
But it'll be back.
For.
A couple of months, the green will be back. So do you have a wish list going into this year? I know you have another new toy that you're going to be playing with that we just got in the fall.
Yeah, it was on back order until September. I was like, hey, thanks for missing daily operation. That's awesome. But we did get a 360 camera, so we're going to be doing some stuff with that. If you've seen ride POVs and stuff like that in 360 are just really cool because being able to look around and see everything. That's really neat. So I've been working on trying to learn how to use that. And as we get into the season, that'll be another thing that'll be coming. So stay tuned.
Cool.
Thank you for joining
us.
And no, you didn't drone on and on.
Oh, God.
Sorry.
that I was going to be boring.
No, this was fun. So thanks a lot. I know you got to run back downstairs and make sure all the cars were fully gone through.
Everybody's cell phones are safe in their cars.
Right. Thank you.
So we'll see after a bit, and we will move on with our amusings. Did everyone enjoy the little ice storm we had a week or so ago? Let's see, it was February 7th, and I walked out and saw a picture of the icicles hanging from the Lewis and Clark cars, and took a picture and put, "Why am I suddenly humming a tune from Oklahoma?" And we got some of the most clever responses. I am very, the first is from one of our seasonal managers on Twitter. He goes by Charles Bradley. We know him as Chuck, who's also a teacher of music or choral music.
Choral music, yes.
At Forest Park in Ferdinand. And so he knew the reference was from Surrey with a Fringe on Top. Mm-hmm. And so he put temporary winter fringe. To which I replied, "Surrey, you jest." Yeah. And then we hear from Tom Powell Jr. at TomPowell72 on Twitter. And he said, "Do they come with a remote starter? Because that would be helpful." I said, "That would be a, wait for it, fringe benefit." Have fun with that. And then on to Facebook. And Jeff Schmidt, who we know from Twitter as Schmee. Remember Schmee?
Right.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. There's a number with that. But Jeff Schmidt. Oh, I see. I see what you did there. Hashtag hobo. That was a good one, Jeff. I appreciate your incredible wit. And then let's see. Who else do we hear from? Todd Richmond on Facebook. Surrey with the fridge on top.
Solid.
Those are all pretty good. And there were definitely some very large icicles.
There were.
All I can think is a tiny little flurry making fringe on top. Just saying. I'm surprised no one said that.
No, well, if you
were. Lame joke, pardon me.
Get onto Facebook and start contributing. It's Leah.
Great. Get right on it.
And now that Jeff Schmidt has brought up Icy, are there any updates in that?
We're still of the world. We're definitely bringing Icy. We're still working on the Big Red flavors. So.
Okay. Does there need to be some sort of campaign or something viral to demand the Big Red Icies? Because now you've brought up the expectations, man.
I know.
We cannot disappoint.
Pretty sure we're going to be able to deliver.
Okay. I'm so excited.
I know.
There will be some sort of announcement made, I'm sure.
And we will need to bring some to the
I will need a sample. Yeah.
Once we know.
You will need to let me know when that happens.
Okay. Speaking of delicious cold things, last podcast we talked about our Dippin' Dots sweepstakes. And one of the ways, which is still ongoing actually for a few more days, one of the ways to enter is by posting a comment on the blog post that hosts the sweepstakes naming the craziest flavor you can think of. So we asked the Pod Squad to take a look at some of the responses and see if there are any that sounded good or any that really didn't sound so good. Want to see what you came up with.
Oh.
Who's got a list? You brought a list, Matt.
Well, I didn't necessarily have a list, but I had a couple that...
What's this piece of paper?
Well, I wanted to give credit to the person that said the one that I liked the most.
Okay.
So I really liked Amy Fortner's. It struck a sentimental chord with me because she said cinnamon red hots. And when she
said sentimental chord, that's kind of honestly one thought.
It struck a chord because my grandma always used to make apple butter and she put cinnamon red hots in it when she made it, which was, I don't know anyone else that does that.
Interesting.
And my mom has tried to recreate it and hers tastes like
cinnamon red hots.
It's not good at all.
Did they dissolve? What did they do?
They did. And they like, I don't know. It just, it gave the apple
that hard.
It gave the apple butter just a really neat flavor. And I don't know. That one just made me think of my grandma. So I'm like, thank you. That was my favorite.
Nice.
Then there was one that was
but
like.
But it doesn't mean you win because all of our winners are chosen at random.
Right. Sorry, you're a winner in my eyes.
That disclaimer at a time.
That means nothing.
That means nothing. The one that I thought was definitely interesting was the biscuits and gravy one.
Yes, several people posted that.
So I get the milkiness part because it's kind of ice creamy, but then when I think of biscuits and gravy, I also think of like sausage.
Yeah.
Like sausage Dippin' Dots don't work for me.
No. That's, gross.
So thanks for playing.
Gross.
I appreciated it, but I saw at least one bacon in there.
There was.
Yes, there were a lot of
honorable
bacon.
Mention.
Honorable mention.
Like, or like bacon with something else. Yeah,
bacon and something.
And bacon chicken ranch pizza.
Oh, I missed that.
Several. So shout out to all of those who posted that.
Leah would have voted for
Chicken
that.
Bacon yes. Ranch.
Yes. And we need our little sound bite.
I'm sure it'll be in.
That's right. Lauren, how about you?
What put together a list. Okay, thank you, phone. So there were a few that I thought just sounded tasty. So I liked funnel cake. I thought that one was pretty awesome idea.
Yeah.
Which flavor of funnel cake? Just traditional?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Or, I mean, you could add some.
How do you convey deep fried, though?
I don't know. But I thought it would be neat if they could do that.
It's Indiana. We could do it.
I feel like, if anyone can find a way.
Could you put Dippin' Dots in a funnel cake?
Ooh. And fry it. Ooh. Flash fry.
We'll talk to Vern.
and then I like, well, this isn't very, like, exciting, but I liked s'mores.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that'd be a good one.
That seems like one they could do. Like, that seems doable.
Yeah. I know, right?
I wonder if they already do.
Well, and this next one I think is extremely doable, but I think it would go over very well at our park, especially during Halloween. Pumpkin cheesecake.
I liked that one too. Yes. I actually wrote that down. That was my other one I wrote down.
Did you?
Yeah.
And then the one that, like, I don't want to eat it, but I thought was hilarious because, like, everyone's like picking these like really outlandish things, like bacon cheeseburger and like buffalo. And like, I'm like, you know, gross, get you, but townhouse crackers. Oh. I was like, genius. Who would want to eat that?
Townhouse crackers.
It's very specific, too.
That's a very niche market there. Right.
Townhouse crackers.
That was my favorite response by far.
It's like, does this person have some of those in their car?
Right.
And they just love them so much. My oldest brother loved. Do you ever hear
like
the crackers?
Butter and salt chicken flavor, and that's it.
Yeah, chicken. Yeah.
He used to get a box of those for his birthday.
I never really understood them either. Those so chicken much. And a biscuit crackers. Like, why are they called that?
I don't know.
I don't know. I don't get it.
Because they're not like chicken flavored, are they?
No, or biscuit. They're crackers, for heaven's sake. So
it tastes fine.
But yeah, that one was
crackers. Well, those would be good with a little peanut butter Dippin' Dots in there, too.
And then I just also had to laugh that clearly autocorrect got everyone.
Yes.
Because there were so many dipping dots.
Yeah.
And it made me smile.
We get that with splashing.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Anything else on your list?
That was what I had.
Yeah. A lot of people want to try pickles.
That's just wrong too.
Pickle flavored Dippin' Dots.
I love pickles. Like, I'm a huge pickle fan, but no.
That's just.
After
just
listening,
like bacon. You just don't do something with bacon. You just don't do something with pickles.
After listening to last week's podcast and them talking about how like the invention of Dippin' Dots was really to get that like creamy texture.
Right.
To me, that just like negates certain flavors, including
like
pickle. Because I just
pickle.
Like, I don't, creamy, well, no, like creamy pickle. Creamy sounds really gross.
Yeah.
I guess some people eat
just
pickles and mayonnaise.
I know.
It sounds like gross on your tongue. It's like, I can't say it.
Somebody else said fried pickles. And I thought the only thing to make pickles worse is fried pickle Dippin' Dots.
I mean, I love pickles and I love fried pickles.
Me too.
And I love Dippin' Dots. I don't want them
all together and you don't have a success story.
But I appreciate the originality of it.
Right.
How about onions? Onion Dippin' Dots.
What kind?
It just said onions.
Like red, yellow, green.
Seriously? Gross.
Does it matter?
I need more specificity than that.
Yeah, here's something.
That's a good word too.
Thank you.
A little cream cheese and barbecue. Which is cream cheese and barbecue something that I'm not aware of?
It is now.
Because it's... I don't know.
I know of a dipping sauce that you can get at Kroger that's like raspberry chipotle dipping sauce, and you mix it with cream cheese and make a pretty good dip, but that's all I got. Maybe it's like a way to make an interesting barbecue sauce. I don't know.
No. I wrote down some Red Hots too because I thought that was neat. And Kathy W. posted, when I ordered Dippin' Dots for my granddaughter, she wanted to know why I ordered her colored pebbles to eat.
Colored pebbles.
That's cute.
Colored pebbles is a good one.
Yeah.
Like fruity pebbles.
Several people posted that as an idea, which I think is probably something.
That's doable, I would think too.
I think the word pebble is better than pellet.
Yes, definitely. Gross.
Yes. Mentioned last
gross.
Time.
Bad pictures come to mind when you say pellet.
Bacon banana waffle.
Oh,
why would you put that together?
I don't know. I don't know.
I feel like someone has, though.
I mean, they have banana waffles, yeah. Certainly. Yeah. Somebody bacon just wants to throw.
That just makes me think of like.
I think it's Rents.
Have you ever seen any of those like compilation things of like some of the worst cooks in America and people who put like spaghetti and ketchup?
That is
a TV show.
I love that show.
Compilations of like people who think that they just made a really great dish and post it online. It's things like spaghetti noodles with ketchup and like really awful things. And people are like, yum, comfort food. On all of these
There's
posts,
no
I'm like,
comfort involved what? In that.
No, I love that show. It makes me feel like I'm Master Chef when I watch it. I'm like, I am so good.
It does make me feel better about my skills.
Bacon, waffle, banana, whatever that is, makes me think.
And by the way, in case
it's really great.
You're a listener who does not go back to the Hello blog to see all the photos and such that we include when we post the each episode, the last one did include Matt's recipe for Brussels sprouts, which you knew off the top of your head. Apparently, he created this on his own.
I did.
Was interesting. So if you're a Brussels sprout lover,
I haven't gotten
or
to that
hater,
point in the last podcast yet.
It's probably good a good stuff. Idea to go and get
I actually made some that
try.
Weekend because I was inspired by talking about it.
The one that I think grossed me out the most, next to pickles and onions, was sauerkraut.
That's just wrong.
There's nowhere on
Again,
this earth that that's
appropriate.
I just
like to add the word creamy in front of all the flavors. You're welcome for that.
And definitely
being a strong German man, that still just does that so well with me.
Something's going around and I think I caught it. Autocorrect was an extra treat here. My kids and husband love the drop-in darts. They like
drop-in darts.
They like cookies and cream. Drop-in darts.
That would 100% be something I would do.
That's a safety hazard.
And then the other one, of course, there are always the huge amount of posts that just say, I want to win, pick me.
And those people can win, right?
Yes, because it is at random.
It's random.
So they're able to do
all
that.
All you have to do.
Other people, I love Holiday World, or I've never had Dippin' Dots, I want some, and things like that. And then somebody, and I'll be very careful how I say this, which I think, I don't know if this was autocorrect or what the intent was, but it said, Puck my family. And I said, what? Too bad Rents isn't here because he'd be on the floor, right? And I just thought, what do I do with this? Because what? And it took me a couple of minutes.
Pick my family.
There it is. I was going a whole other place with that.
I'm sure you
thinking,
did.
Thinking, I need to do something and fix this. And so anyway, it's been fixed. But that one kind of startled me. But yeah, good old autocorrect.
Why would autocorrect pick?
I don't know.
Maybe they just said Puck in something else.
Yeah, it might be a hockey player who uses that word a lot.
Could be.
Yeah. You never know.
Or curler.
And here, meanwhile, there is still time to enter our We Love Dippin' Dots sweepstakes through Monday afternoon, February the 19th. Go to holidayworld.com and click on, well, if you're on desktop, click on where it says blog. And if you're on mobile, click on Holoblog. But either way, get to our blog and look for the We Love Dippin' Dots sweepstakes. There are a lot of ways to enter. It's all outlined there for you when you get to the page. We will have three winners chosen at random who will each win a pair of Holiday World tickets plus 1 gallon of Dippin' Dots.
That is so cool.
They will not be sauerkraut Dippin' Dots, I assure you.
They will be delicious. And a gallon of Dippin' Dots is
a whole lot of dots.
It's a lot. It's a huge amount. As we all kind of had our full at the last episode and we barely scraped the
surface.
But
they would almost have to eat them like immediately because you have to have them at a certain temperature.
Do you have just like a big Dippin' Dots party on the day it arrives?
You would. You have to be ready for it. Well, it will compact
in dry ice.
In dry ice, so you'd be able to use that. Will probably last a couple of days.
Yeah.
So that will be delivered to your door. I'm sure the Dippin' Dots people will make it work for you and get it delivered. So that they'll arrive just as you're gathering for your Dippin' Dots party. So please do enter.
Sounds like
a
cool party to have.
I know. Who else gets Dippin' Dots?
Exactly.
At their home.
Exactly.
It's fun.
Lots of fun. And if you're listening to this episode and February 19th has passed, still go over to the blog because I bet there's a sweepstakes going on. We like to have fun with these things. We'll have another one soon. I have to do our annual cabin fever. sweepstakes that we do with Lake Rudolph, and then you get to stay in a cabin when you visit Holiday World, so that's pretty cool.
Very nice.
This is not part of our holiday section because this holiday has already passed, but did everybody have a nice Valentine's Day? That was just, what, 2 days ago?
Yep. Yes. I celebrated my anniversary that day.
That was your holiversary.
Yeah. My holiversary, yeah.
It's not your wedding anniversary, too. No. But it's Brandon's.
His
he was married on Valentine's Day, as was Mike Johannes, our sales director. Two romantic guys.
Aren't they?
Aw.
I just started working that day. You started
working. What a special day.
Other way. But we had a wonderful guest blog post from a longtime entertainer with the park. Did everybody get to read it?
I did, yeah.
That was sweet, yeah.
And everything. Do you want to tell the story a little bit, Matt? Because I know you were involved.
Yeah, so Amanda Barnett was one of our entertainers. And kind of the backstory for her, she auditioned for us when she was 16. And I remember going to the auditions with our director of entertainment at the time, Sandy Fortune, and we went to Oakland City. And Amanda came out, and you know, she auditioned, and I leaned over to Sandy. I'm like, I want her on our show. She is fantastic. Sandy's like, oh, well, let's wait. We got more people we need to see, and this is the first audition. We got more to go. And I'm like, what is wrong with you? Like, she's amazing. Like, she's really good. She's like, just wait. So then, like, more auditions came through, and so at the end, you know, they were like, well, what do you think? I'm like, I want Amanda Barnett in our shows. And Sandy's like, you don't know that yet. You need to see. I'm like, Sandy, she's awesome. Like, what is your problem? She's like, okay, she's my niece. She's like, I didn't want you to know that because I didn't want you to give her preferential treatment. And I'm like, no preferential treatment. She's
so instead she went straight negative.
She went the other way, right? Yeah, she's all right. Okay. She's okay.
She's okay.
So she joined our shows when she was 16 years old and has been kind of part of the Holiday World family since then in some way, shape, or form, and has been in a lot of different shows. And she's now been in several of the Halloween shows that Lauren and Leah put together the past few years. And she's just a great, great person. So she got married this past summer, and she reached out to me and said, hey, you know, we have kind of this backstory with how we met and our first date, and could we maybe come back to the park after our wedding and get a few wedding shots there? I'm like, absolutely, that'd be fantastic. So they did. And so then Paul and I were talking. I said, Amanda would be a great person to write a story or be a guest on the podcast. Just kind of, she's definitely a true ambassador of what we're all about and what we represent. And she did a great job.
It's a wonderful story.
It really is.
So we're not going to give away the ending and why there's a picture of them sitting on a bench together, but it's a neat story. So again, head over to the Hollow Blog to read the Valentine's Day love letter from Amanda Class is now her name, now that she's a married woman. And it would not be a holiday for me without receiving multiple cards from our friend Brian Lighty. And I did bring them with me today because they were so hilarious. The first is a card with a couple of dinosaurs, T-Rexes, looking at each other. Of course, hugging is not
funny.
Is not easy for the short-limbed Tyrannosaurus Rex. And then there's also a guy and a gal, and he's sitting, and he just opened the heart-shaped box and said, is this box filled with bacon? Yep. God, I love you.
True love.
So, and I think there's a note in here, make sure Matt sees this. So now you've seen it. Brian, you're wonderful. Thank you so much.
Those are great.
And I always feel bad. It's like, and I didn't send you anything. So I'll send you a shout out, Brian. I don't think that quite measures up, but thank you so much
cute.
For thinking of us. And I always picture him in the card store and coming up with, what are you laughing at, man?
The way he crossed out, it says, happy Valentine's Day to a sizzling hot husband. He marked out husband and put coastal rife.
Exactly once. That's okay too. We are Holiday World and we love holidays. Let's talk about a couple of special days coming up in the next couple of weeks. First of all, this coming Sunday, February 18th, is the birth date of Santa Jim Yellick, who's Lauren and Leah's great grandfather, who was the first Santa here at the park and really became known nationally as Santa Claus. And he was born on February 18th of 1894.
Wow.
So we'll definitely do. We'll put a picture of him in his very first Santa suit, which was during World War I when he donned a Santa suit on board a ship. He was in the Navy to help. They brought some underprivileged kids on board. This was in New York, and he enjoyed it so much, seeing their little faces, you know, during the war. That's a scary time, and their little faces brighten up, and he made a promise to God, if you'll get me through this war, I will forever be Santa Claus. And they both kept their, I know, yeah. I get a chill thinking of that. So we will always remember Santa Jim, very mm-hmm. important part of our Santa Claus legacy. February 19th, the very next day, which is Monday, this also will give us a chill. It's 75 days till opening day. Maybe that's why Brent isn't here. He's the countdown. It's him.
Going quickly.
So it's exciting. Yes.
It is. We have a lot to do.
We yes. do have. We always. We somehow. We always do it though.
We do. Yeah.
Somehow. It's always so great to see the rides put back together and the leaves budding and the flowers coming out and
new employees showing up.
New employees getting trained and ready to go and then the happy laughter of our guests coming up on May the 5th. And if you have a Platinum Season Pass, then you can come on May the 4th on
yep.
Friday. And I know in the future, Lauren will be giving us some information about
Star Wars Day.
What we'll be doing.
Yes, May the 4th be with you.
Amanda and I are busy working on it.
Great. We'll have a special preview for the Platinum Season Pass holders. So if you've already got season passes, it's just a $30 upgrade to be a Platinum Season Pass holder. And then you get to get here in 74 days instead of 75 days. February the 23rd is also Curling is Cool Day. This does not reference hair. This references a certain
That's cool too, though.
Sport I mean. In the Olympics, which I know nothing about. So I'm going to let you guys talk about curling because you got really excited about it before we started here.
I loved curling so much.
Well, first really of all, Leah curling. Is obsessive with the Winter Olympics.
Like yes.
I love the Winter Olympics yeah. so much.
It's what she lives for.
I almost wore my like Olympic coat today.
You have an Olympic coat?
I do.
Yeah.
Went like to a coats. Ralph Lauren factory store, like the jackets that they have.
What?
But it was from like 8 years ago, yeah. probably. Yeah. So yeah, every year or every like Olympics, yeah. like the polo jacket
like goes on sale somewhere.
They will sell like versions of it that anyone can buy after the Olympics.
That is
I
amazing.
Found it at the factory store one, yeah. and.
You didn't even think twice about buying it, did
oh,
you?
No.
She was like, yes, Olympic coat.
I looked at the price just to make sure it wasn't going to be like too much, right. but it was like 50% off. And I was like, done.
And are you being Sold. Careful and only wearing it once in a while so you don't wear it out? I mean, do you love it that much? Is that why you don't have it on today?
Yes.
Okay. So you're not one of those
I did wear it for
it's threadbare.
I did wear it really heavily when I first got it and I didn't care when I wore it. Now I'm
so
like
is
special
it Olympic
occasions
specific?
Only.
Like, is it specific to that?
It says like Team USA.
For a certain year or?
I don't think
no.
so.
Okay.
No, I don't think so.
So I don't know if they come out with like a different one, like every.
They do well, I mean, come they out do. With different ones, but I don't think this, I think this was like more inspired by the style of jacket okay. than it was looked, actually like the actual jacket. But.
I think it was just like missing like one like little like the little like Olympic
the actual
patch or
Olympic
something like that
emblem or something.
Something like that.
But have you seen
I bet you could find that Olympic patch somewhere if you tried hard enough.
Sure I could. Have you seen the viral video this week of the curling? That's one of those little robotic vacuum cleaners and somebody with a Swiffer.
No,
it's out there. I think a lot of people have seen it on Facebook.
That's funny.
And it's
oh my gosh,
was created
that's
in funny. Owensboro, so it's kind of like yay Owensboro for coming up with
that. That's funny.
I think like national news has used it because it was so nutty.
That's fantastic.
That is.
And Lauren, the next generation is also in love with curling. Apparently, she was telling us.
Yes, I was feeding Sawyer yesterday.
Who is how old?
Just a little over 3 months.
Okay,
I was giving him a bottle and. I was burping him in my lap and I had the TV on so that way I could, you know, watch something while I was feeding him. And all of a sudden he just stares up at the TV and he's just, he was completely like just zoned out. He was like, yes, this. So
he takes after his Aunt Leah.
Yes.
He has fallen in love with curling. And really, I think all of the Winter Olympic sports.
He just loves snow.
Especially, yeah. He likes the snow on TV. It's white and bright. But
he does really like after curling. Aunt Leah's heart. I have to believe that.
So
we'll go with that.
Yeah.
We will definitely include in the blog post about this podcast episode, we'll include a Sawyer photo.
An awesome picture.
It's so cute. Cool. I may or may not have, when she texted that to us, said Aunt Leah's never been more proud.
So are you going to give him your jacket someday?
Ooh, maybe.
Ooh. Are you that
but
proud?
Like, he's going to have to prove his love of the Winter Olympics.
Don't worry. He'll probably only be able to wear it for a few months and then he'll get it right back.
Yeah, that's true.
So do you have a desire or plan to actually go to the Winter Olympics at some point?
One day. I've actually talked about one day going to any Olympics as a part of my honeymoon. Like, that's how much I love the Olympics.
My son asked me the other day if I would take him to the Olympics at some point.
I want to go.
And I said, yeah. Which one? He's like, probably the summer. I'm not really big on the snow sports.
Honestly.
I know.
Honestly, when they announced it was in South Korea, I've just always wanted to go to South Korea. I don't know why.
It's going to be next time? Or the Summer Olympics? Where's the Summer Olympics?
Yeah. I can't come up with it right now. I'm so disappointed in myself.
Might not real fast.
My brain has forgotten that information. But no, when I found out it was in South Korea, because I've just always wanted to go. I've always wanted to see Seoul.
You considered it.
I very seriously considered it. Then I applied for the MBA program and got in and realized I was going to be a student during that time. So that kind of threw a wrench into my plans. But
well, maybe long term, we should put in
Tokyo. Let's go.
Ooh, fine.
Summer Olympics.
Maybe we should put in a bid for Santa Claus, Indiana to host. Well, now that we have
the airport, Hall Olympics.
Close enough.
According to Lifetime TV, we have an airport. So we can
support that many people.
Totally.
That's right. Totally.
Beijing for the next Winter Olympics.
Oh, yeah. That's why I couldn't remember it, because they're both like.
So we're going with the whole Asian.
Yeah. We're sticking over there for a while. I mean, I've always wanted to go to Asia, so. I guess India technically is part of Asia, but it's a subcontinent.
There is, you know, if you go to Tokyo, there's Tokyo Disney.
Yes. I want to see that so much.
So you have 4 years to plan. We'll still find a husband doing this darn podcast, I'm sure, in 4 years.
I want a honeymoon.
We're going to the Olympics.
So it's going to be a prerequisite. Your husband has to like the Olympics.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
I mean, I don't.
Will you ask that question on the first date? To disqualify
them. I just like, don't even think that
pre-date.
I just don't even think that I could connect with someone who doesn't really love the Olympics. Like, I just don't think it's going to go beyond a couple of dates if they don't like the Olympics. So it's just kind of a natural thing.
Why would I ask the first date then, so you don't waste more time?
That's a good point.
Yeah.
it should be one of your screening questions.
Yeah. Are you worthy of future opportunities with me?
Are you willing to spend the honeymoon at the Olympics?
Did you know with our pick your price, I'm moving on. Online ticket discounts, you could save up to $20 per general admission ticket and save a little bit more by using the official Holiday World Podcast promo code HOWOPO. HOWOPO, not ho ho ho. So many people.
I bet that is
it doesn't
hashtag.
Work. And I always add the emphasis when I retell.
A
private message. I don't know that people are yet necessarily yelling at me. But simply
slow-mo.
Simply go to holidayworld.com/save and drop in ho wo po and let the savings begin. It is time for ho wo po. We're still saying it. And then after a while,
feedback. Now just read it all really and slowly.
Nothing sounds right after. It's like, I even say
why don't you
right.
have the ho wo coco? Read the ho wo po slow mo feedback.
And what was it? The ho wo po, the po po polos or something?
Oh,
like
yeah.
That?
Yeah. The ho wo po po polos.
So,
yeah.
Yeah, because it's ho-wo po-po for police.
All right, I'm lost.
Ho-wo po-po polo.
First, we heard from New England Coaster Club on Twitter, at Bizarro Fanatic. Can I get some Big Red? I need more Voyage in my life. Number one wooden coaster out of over 258 different coasters I've been on all over the world. So thank you, Bizarro. Bizarro Fanatic, maybe you need a different Twitter handle. We'll be watching New England Coaster Club. And where in New England are you from? Because that's where my roots are.
Yeah.
My roots.
My roots.
We also heard
through a Midwestern twang.
I don't know what that was. We also heard from Nick Weesey at Nick James Weesey. Holiday World, I hope the podcast gets 100 episodes. That would be amazing. Hashtag HOWOPO. Thank you,
Nick. So that would be like two more years, right?
Because we just had our 2 year anniversary of the first episode, and so we celebrated accordingly. Did anybody remember? No.
I saw the email with the picture.
Some people did. Yeah. So
that's about it.
That was nice. Yes, the coaster crew remembered.
Yes,
so that helped.
Thank you.
I'm glad that they
to remind us. We also heard from Braxton Wright at Team Porker 46. Holiday World, can't wait for the job fair March 2nd. Got my fingers crossed. I've been wanting to be part of it since I was little, going with my grandparents.
Aww.
And then little emojis, little Santa and Mrs. Claus emojis, hashtag. Oh, good luck, Braxton. Yes. Remember to smile. Let's each give Braxton a little bit of a tip on how to do well at the job fair. Remember to smile.
Remember to smile, make eye contact, and, you know, try to be very bubbly and talkative. Like, when questions are asked, offer a response.
That's what I was going to say. Like, try your hardest not to be shy.
Yeah, I think when I was helping walk employees to the group interviews a couple of years ago, I started, after watching a couple sessions, started finally like making them do a cheer before they went in so that they would
loosen up
a little bit. I'm sure they hated me.
But I was just like,
you know what? We don't ask hard questions. We're not trying to trick you. We just want you to show us your personality. So don't be afraid to show it.
And don't forget to bring your comfort pencil.
And everyone has a personality. They don't all have to be the same. We need all different kinds of personalities here. So
be you.
Be good.
Good. Is that a school? That's Ball State. No, BSU is Ball State. BU sounded like.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I just tell my kids all the time, be the best you that you can be. And that's my advice to them.
Now, here's someone else who's being the best person they can be. Sean Keith at SKAIA1 said when, and this is a basketball player, is not dropping bombs for you, Indy MBB. He's moonlighting at Holiday World's Gobbler Getaway. Great game tonight, Trevor. And he's referencing Trevor Lakes, who plays basketball for the University of Indianapolis men's basketball team. He's number 31. Gosh. And he did a side-by-side photo of him next to a character from Gobbler Getaway. Does everyone know his name? Does anyone know the character's name? I had to double check because it's a kind of a funny name. But it's the farmer. Sure. The farmer who asks for our help in gathering
turkeys. Do we reference it during the ride?
I know the name. Why do I know the name? Yes, we know the last name.
You just made it up in your head.
I did not. It's in an old blog post.
I'm going to go with Farmer Bob.
That is so far from...
That's exactly what I was thinking.
Farmer Bob? What does that even
mean? Farmer Brown?
I don't know.
No, his first name, and this was delivered by the folks at Sally Corp, because they're the ones who designed the dark ride, is his first name is Cornelius, which a farmer and corn, Cornelius, and old-fashioned. That was a great old-fashioned name. And his last name is Van Snoodle.
Yes!
Yeah, okay. So he's Farmer Van Snoodle. And Snoodle is that
farmer
little...
Farmer Bob was close.
No, it was nowhere near. Just the farmer part.
All right.
To be fair, I was going to go with Farmer Cletus.
You wouldn't Cornelius. Be, you got C in there. And like,
I know. I've been guy in the club.
You're pretty
a name
close.
From another time, brother. For sure.
But the, his brother's Cletus. Yeah.
But the snoodle Cornelius is off Cletus. Of a turkey. The little thingy that kind of goes around their little mouth. What are they?
Oh, I always thought that was like a made up thing.
The gobble?
The I don't know. Waddle I is call the
it
thing.
Like a thneed. Somebody made it up.
A thneed from the Lorax.
The
snoodle, sure.
The snoodle's the little thingy that puts something on the bottom.
The dangly thing, right?
Yeah. And then the little,
The thing that, what was that?
I'm just going to make wide gestures around my face like Lauren did, so that way it covers everything.
Snoodle.
Something in this area.
That's what we'd be doing if we had them, because they drive us crazy, I think. But yeah, the thing that's right by their beak, right? Because turkeys have beaks. The thing that kind of goes to the side.
Well, it starts to their beak, and then it like dangles.
Yeah, it goes off to the side. And I always wonder, does it mean something if it's on one side versus the other side?
It's like a graduation tassel.
That's exactly the higher
I was thinking like earrings.
But I'm sure
they're
there'll be
snoods.
Paul and I are too like my
just snood.
Okay, so it's not a snood.
You're close.
Okay.
Everybody needs a thneed and everyone needs a snood.
We'll have to do
a snoodle.
A call out to both Sally as well as to Sean Keith.
And a star-bellied snitch.
This as Sneeches. Well as Trevor Lakes, and good luck to you in your basketball career. And you do look like you could be the great great grandson of old Cornelius or Farmer Bob, depending on what he uses his
or
nickname.
Maybe he's the grandson of his brother Cletus.
Oh, it could be. And Trevor Lakes responded to his friend. He said, "I found my twin."
Oh, I'm glad he took it in stride.
That's cute. We also heard from our friend Jonathan Williams at JLWEVV. Remember, he was the guy who made the little bacon cups we all kind of hungered for last time.
Right. Remember, he had. Don't make me hungry again.
He said, listening to the Holiday World Ho-Oh-Po.
Just think of creamy sauerkraut. That'll take it away.
That'll kill it. That'd be kind of like the best diet ever. Is just think. Yeah, creamy sauerkraut, creamy pickles.
Every time you go to eat a bite, just say aloud, creamy sauerkraut.
I was like, no, thank you. And Jonathan has to say, while they were announcing the new Dippin' Dots flavor, I was slightly disappointed it wasn't bacon flavored. And I know that Mr. Rents was very disappointed that I think he was hoping that this could be the first episode that we would not once mention.
He said
he was going
to
be disappointed, though, if it was the episode.
If it was.
Because he wouldn't be part of it.
Yeah. Okay, that's right. And then I remember thinking, is there any way we can make this work? And I thought, no, there's already feedback in there. So. Yeah.
And the card has bacon on it.
There was
no pope.
Didn't want to drop that. We got to leave the bacon in because bacon is ubiquitous.
Yes.
Another good word. This is a long bacon. Word day.
We need to make a list of all the great words that were used in this podcast.
Okay, you can do that.
Okay, I'm up to three.
We'll add words of the day from the podcast.
Yes, yes.
But not just
words
one.
To look up. Words we looked up for you. Next, we heard from Alyssa W., who is Alyssa Y., at AKWEIHE. Just finished listening to the Holiday World podcast. I award at Eric Rents 4 points for making me have the River of Dreams stuck in my head.
You're giving him points for that?
Yes.
I would take away points for that.
Hashtag happily singing. So Alyssa's a Billy Joel fan, apparently.
Well, I am too, but that was very obscure.
And my son, John, who you all know, texted me apparently when he listened to it. Well, Eric Rents did the 25 Degrees of Separation.
Right. I knew that.
River Not well, Dreams. But he
I'll
did
listen to that on the next leg of my drive.
Okay. Well, he was trying to get us to say River of Dreams and we weren't. Getting it.
No. And he was so disappointed.
He was because he was just sure. And that is disappointing when you really think everybody's going to get it and everybody just looks at you like, why are you doing this to us?
I'm just saying, when I did 70 Degrees of Separation, I left it wide open. Yes. I was like, I didn't even come up with anything. Just amuse me.
Yes.
I just think that's the best way to do it. I'm just saying.
You win.
Just amuse me.
So I got a text from my son, John, who, texted, River of Dreams, you dang fools. Billy Joel, 1993 was all I needed. And my response to my middle son was, ha, I had a little one at that time, a hymn, and only knew nursery rhymes. So sometimes you don't keep up with modern culture, Lauren, if you haven't noticed already. You look back, and those are like missing years. So I just...
That's what I've heard.
I did, yeah. I
Is that supposed to be encouraging, or...
No, because your years were filled with the joy of a little one who then called you a dang fool.
You're just going to lose touch with the outside world now.
Goodbye, society.
That's right.
Hello, society.
We'll see you in maybe 8 years, maybe 18 years.
Don't worry, Rents will keep you up to date on all the changing words.
Yes. Right, what?
I still
was that fun or was that obnoxious yesterday?
Both.
I just finally said, I'm putting my phone down. I have work to do.
Both.
But it was...
What was it? Pressed?
What was he saying? That he would be pressed?
I'm like depressed.
Like irritated. I think he was trying to say irritated, but he used the word pressed instead of...
So, like, a thing of like shortening
it. A word?
Yeah. Is that like when people say V instead of very? Like, I'm the disappointed. I'm the pressed.
I don't like that.
I don't either.
Me either.
I gave him a lot of lecture.
I think he was trying to be cool.
Changing words.
Yeah.
Whatever.
And he tried to defend himself.
Well, and then we got 8,500
just feeding up GIFs.
Yeah, we miss you, Eric. Come back soon.
Bring we love bacon. You.
I do that in part because he lives and breathes by GIF. So I try to find the most
ridiculous speak his language.
Ones and speak his language back.
Although, to be fair, I like exclusively send 30 Rock GIFs.
Really? That's the only ones you do?
I love Liz Lemon GIFs so much.
I did a search for an oboe GIF and could not find one.
What?
But what's truly disappointing is there are lots of GIFs that popped up when I did a search for oboe and not one was an oboe. It's like, that's not an oboe.
Do we need
and that's
Rents
an
to help me make one?
I believe that's...
Since Rents makes GIFs.
After we apologize for talking about it.
Have you seen his
like
GIF that he made for Maury Povich? Him and the...
No.
Oh, I think I have it.
That's amazing.
It is amazing.
We have to put that into general circulation, I think.
We do.
I think so. Yeah. It needs to go online.
Any Eric Rents GIF needs to go into circulation.
Yes, we need to get the one where he's part of the water ballet. Have you seen that?
Yeah.
I finally got to see the video.
What?
They did water Wait, ballet.
I thought what? It didn't. I thought a video didn't exist.
I what? Saw it. And apparently it was shown at the IROC training.
What?
To all different parks who now want to incorporate.
How do we get access to this?
No, I think we just go take it. Are you looking at the... Oh, the rents. The Maury Povich in the audience after his training.
He's the most expressive audience member.
And I said that was very well staged. He's like, no, I was being sincere. Like, you totally were not.
I mean, the reasons he's on the podcast is because he has big reactions. Like,
he does.
And we love him for
I
that.
I will share this with you all so you'll have it.
I just love that so much. I need that in my life.
Speaking of our 2-year anniversary, we heard from IBWIP at IBWIPCOM, whom we have not heard from in a while. So welcome back. Happy 2-year Annie in advance. Annie, I guess, short for anniversary. A-N-N-Y. I haven't missed an ep and don't plan on it either. Hoping to make the trip down again this summer. Thanks to the whole cast. And come on, Eric Rentz, get the tattoo already or I'm coming down to drag you to get it.
Thank you for that.
Yes.
Thank you for that.
Hashtag Eric won't see this for 3 weeks. Ha 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 ha.
True.
No, he'll catch up on Twitter.
He caught up. Actually, earlier this week, he caught up. So he, I think, was very offended. He said, it's only been 1 week.
Oh, jeez.
Yes. I love that he gets caught up on Twitter. Sorry, I used air quotes.
Caught up.
He's all caught up again. And it's just,
we love you, Eric.
Yes.
Just shake my
also,
head.
I'm going to apologize for our rude pauses while Matt rolled his eyes at all of the shortened words. It's what we do. I'm sorry.
Yes. And
I have two teenage daughters, so I felt like I was reading their tweets.
Yes. And IBWIP continued saying, as a fellow podcaster, and he had a shout out for Steven. Steven does a lot to help make the podcast so good. I can tell the little edits and such. Give him a thumbs up. High five for adding the sound effect on episode 51 on the winning number of 2,000 Dippin' Dots.
That was nice.
Laura got
well
it.
Done. That it was.
Point I have on. Not heard that.
It's fantastic. Exact number. And I know Steven was like, I got to add sound effects. So it was.
Are we going to do our number game this time too? I've got a number.
Yes.
Is that coming up? Okay.
Actually, I forgot to put it in the lineup, but we'll do that in just a minute. Well, let's do that next because I'll forget again. And that's really rude. So we've added of me to forget.
Oh,
I didn't forget to get your number though. So that was
you did. I got my number.
So did you know we now play Leah? That we now play,
I heard that.
Give me a number. So that's Matt's deal.
Yeah. So in honor of our special guest today, how many questions were on the test that he took to get his drone license? We know what percentage he got. He told us the percentage. How many questions were on this?
And
this
while
scary
you're
test?
Thinking, because they're both Leah's calculating, and Lauren's saying whatever she says, I'm saying one number left.
Did he say how long it took him?
I don't think he did. I don't think
he was going for at least an hour, because somebody was going to come in an hour.
I'm gonna say 50.
I'm gonna go 60.
Okay, it Get runs in the family. Get out the
again.
Sound effect because Leah got it right on the money this time.
What?
I'm sure Steven.
This just seemed like a 60 question test.
Just seemed like they're taking the fun out of this game.
60 question test.
And he said that each test is different. There are far more than 60 questions, so it's kind of like the raffle copper where when we choose someone at random and you just click on the button, and they do that for each test. They click on whatever randomizer button, and so his test would have been different from the guy sneezing in the next cubicle over.
So could they have like 180 questions?
Or potentially. Like, yeah, I don't know how many there are total, but there are
I assume they
far
randomly
pick 60.
The same number for everybody.
Everybody gets 60 questions.
Okay. And I assume that there's
questions.
Like
different combination.
A mix. I assume there's a certain amount of like
so he can run
style questions, meteorological questions, and a certain number of.
Right.
Yeah. So that way.
So
yeah.
Well done.
Leah's breaking it down.
That MBA
I know
is
so
not
much about
waste.
It's not.
I've learned so much about standardized
analysis. Thing that you learned or
I've learned so much about standardized testing from all the like behavioral economics podcasts I listen to that like yeah
hey I still guess the process right
you were close and that's what it's really important
yeah, that was really I went home that day and asked my husband how many Dippin' Dots do you think he was nowhere close. I even let him guess several times and he's still
was he way
I was trying
low?
To guess yes. along and I was way low
Yeah.
I was thinking like max like 500.
That's I think Mike started off with like the low hundreds or something like that. And I was like, nope.
Did you laugh at him?
Yeah, a little bit.
Like that's sad. You're not on my level.
We also heard from Tony Clark from Cedar Point. If you listened to our last episode, the little war. So I gave him a shout out, and we always do a couple of tweets with shout outs for each episode. And he responded, "I'd be happy to have lunch with you anytime." P.S. That was the new guy, John, on that one, because we weren't sure if Tony was the fellow chiming in. And then he said, "Looks like the timing was delicious for everyone." Thumbs up. So that was
solid.
Very,
I respect that.
Very sweet. Next, we heard from 808 Coaster Rida at 808 Coaster RIDAH. And he said, "My Valentine, hashtag the voyage," and included a nice picture of the voyage. So that is his voyage. And next, we heard from Alyssa's husband at David Y on Twitter. And he said that he and Alyssa were going through very early Kevin pictures tonight. We all love baby Kevin. I was wearing a Holiday World shirt in one of my first pics of me holding him. So a very, very sweet photo of David and little itty bitty Kevin.
He that looks like a tiny baby.
Very.
I did not have a newborn. Tiny baby.
Ever. I didn't either.
No.
It's like, no, mine were never that small. So
I actually have a friend on Facebook who her baby just turned 8 months and posted like the stats. My child at 3 months is a half inch shorter and 3 pounds lighter than an 8 month old baby.
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah, you know. You had yourself a football player.
We keep saying he's going to be a basketball player.
Okay.
Well, he's really not. He's not fat at all. Like he's not,
he can still bulk up.
Yeah. Okay. He's just really tall.
I'm going to need him actually to get some like rolls on his thighs. He's got like a little, but like, I just need your child to beef up a little bit.
Sausage legs.
Nothing personal. I think he's really cute.
He has
already,
one roll.
But,
yeah.
One roll. But his arms are really skinny. It's so cute. His stomach's pretty skinny too.
Oh,
abs.
Oh, I remember when my first child, Thomas, was born, and immediately, even though I haven't lived in New England for many, many years, I immediately said, "He's a buster," which a buster, just a big kid.
Yeah.
And, but it was just weird that that would pop into my head right after I popped out the child. A buster. So anyway, so thank you for sharing that with us, David. That's a sweet, sweet,
sweet
photo. Next, we heard from Matt Higgins at MDMC0, I think it's a 001. He said, "I'm very much looking forward to riding Thunderbird and Voyage during Hollywood Nights." Hollywood Nights is coming up.
Yeah.
You're here for you.
And Hollywood Nights is our special event for members of 11 different roller coaster clubs. There are partner clubs, and you can get more information at holidayworld.com/clubs. If you're not a member of one of these clubs, join them because they're fun, and you get to meet other coaster crazies just like you, and then get to come and ride roller coasters till late.
Yep.
On Friday and Saturday night.
I love that crowd.
It's a good time.
June 1 and 2.
Good time.
I love them.
It'll be really good. Then we heard from Tom Powell Jr. at Tom Powell 72. And he said that cabana reservation rule. Remember we talked about him last time around about how he asked about it. And we were like, yeah, we don't need to do that anymore. So we stopped. He said that cabana reservation rule change was huge. All caps, huge for my planning. Got to have that cabana number 17. See you in August. Yes.
He's throwing it out there.
Some people get
it's dangerous.
There.
What if someone else wants it then?
I know.
That's why not having a 30-day or 60-day limit to when you can get it. So, Tom, I know we'll be staying up to till midnight on February 28th, waiting for it to be, is it March 1st or March 15th? March 1st is when cabanas
March 1st.
Will be available online. And we will see you in August in cabana number 17. Now we have to put that on our calendar. Then we're going to go meet Tom in cabana 17 in August. Well,
check all of August.
Yeah, I guess we could look at Tom. Be creepy about that.
Really stalker.
Poor Tom.
I like how, you know, sometimes people spot us out in the park. We're going to go out spotting guests.
That's
in the park.
Right. We know you're here. Next, we heard from the Diz Nerd, which I love that so much, at Scott R021. I really am, this was on February 8th, I really am craving a blue-red swirl from Utterly Blue Ice Cream right now.
right now.
This has been happening about once a week where somebody just posts a craving for a funnel cake or for red and blue, utterly blue ice cream. So
love it.
78 days.
You can
come get it because Utterly Blue will be open. We had a major cheese ball event occurrence just yesterday. And I bring this up. And the cheese balling, of course, is when someone tags us, especially on Twitter, really by mistake, thinking we're someone else. And this company tagged us thinking they were tagging themselves. I think I've talked about Holiday World RV before. I guess I'll just say who they are. But we got on board Twitter early enough that we got the handle of at Holiday World. And they are at Holiday World _RV. Well, they tweeted yesterday, oh, it's a great weekend at Holiday World. Check out our latest ad for the New Mexico. Then there's a YouTube link and then hashtag Thursday Thoughts. Well, last time they did that, I private messaged them, or direct messaged them and said, oh, sorry, I think. And they fixed it right away. Yeah. Well, now they've either, they haven't blocked me because it tells you if you're blocked, but now they no longer allow direct messages. So I wasn't able to do it, but I went ahead and tweeted them and said, thanks for tagging us, but I'm not sure that was your intent. So they did go back in, but they have a little t-shirt, a girl with curly hair wearing a World of Difference Holiday World t-shirt
that, that
uses their logo.
Can we use it?
Let's take it. I mean, they're using our Twitter handle. We might as well use their t-shirt. But anyway, Holiday World RV, they're down in, I know their home office is in Texas, but this is something in New Mexico. So I hope they have a great weekend. And I think we're going to have a rainy, snowy weekend.
Yeah.
Anyway, and finally, the Coaster Crew. I think I sent one of them out. Well, here's one I probably should have sent out so everybody could study ahead of time. But I think I finally have it figured out because they took, you know, when John takes the time to do to celebrate the periodic table.
That's awesome.
Oh my gosh.
He put, want to hear a joke about sodium and hydrogen? Nah, NaH. We hope we're not boring you with our Holiday World periodic table of fun, but it's a noble cause. Well, we've made you sulfur enough puns. It's like, I love these guys.
Gosh.
Or John. Is it John? Yeah. Does John act alone? I don't think we asked him when we did, when we interviewed him. I think
he does primarily, and he's sometimes made
fun of.
Does he
have an assistant?
Yeah. For how much he goes into this head-on.
We will never make fun of you, John. You are a master. You're awesome. He said, we made you sulfur enough puns, but you'll miss us when we are gone. Hashtag periodic table day.
Oh my gosh.
I will put this on the blog post so you can study it too. I don't know, ladies, if you can see the periodic table that he drew on the board. Mm-hmm. Have you figured out the code of what he has posted there?
Yes.
That
is
the periodic table of fun. And I finally figured out
the code.
I looked like three different times. I thought, I can't figure this out. But I looked yesterday.
And this one was the key to me.
Go ahead and tell us what
TB 15, Thunderbird 15.
So the numbers
correspond with the year we built it. So 02 was Zimbabwe?
Yes. Yes.
Yep.
He put a lot of time into this.
It's just so unbelievable.
Gosh.
And 19 with a question mark.
Are there any props? And I just have a black and white copy here on my notes here, but are there any props in there that we should?
We've got,
it looks like it's like a chemistry lab kind of stuff.
Type of things. And
is Sam up to anything?
Little pen. Sam just kind of off in the corner, it looks like.
Yeah.
Well, we appreciate Coaster Crew.
Wow.
And that's so good. Wow.
Adam from at Theme Park Fam said, those Holiday World mascots have some wonderful chemistry. And then Zach Fuller at Zach ZB Fuller said, oh, GE is on the periodic table. I had to look it up. It looks like geranium, but there's an extra syllable in it. So it's something like geranium.
Oh.
I took chemistry, but it was a very long time ago. And then Zach also tweeted again, I had more chemistry jokes, but they were bad. So I bury them.
This
has been,
I love that.
Oh, terrific host. And our second post from our friends at the Coaster Crew, let me get this so you can see it, is in commemoration of our anniversary of 2 years of podcasting, the touch, the feel of cotton, the fabric of a hashtag happy anniversary to the Hot Squad. We went with a traditional second anniversary gift of cotton. So there's like cotton everywhere.
Yes.
Including a cotton cake. So maybe we should have cotton flavored Dippin' Dots. Somebody needs to enter
with
that
candles,
in the contest.
That seems a little dangerous.
That does seem like a little poofy.
That's a good point.
The modern version, you know how they always have the traditional version?
Yes.
And the modern version, if you prefer, is China. Since we were made there, we've got that covered too.
That's so funny.
Oh, John. That is so amazing. So thank you, Coaster
Never
Crew.
Never cease to amaze us.
And if you're looking for a coaster club to join, Coaster Crew is one of our partner clubs. And I know they'd love to have you as a member. And they have a sense of humor, that's for sure. And the Big Green Foot, who will be making a return appearance at Hollywood Nights. So if you're so into excited. All this,
we need to like create like a special podium for the Big Green Foot.
Oh my gosh.
And maybe security. Maybe we're going to need, by now, we might need security to accompany John and the Big Green Foot wherever they go in the park.
Maybe.
It's an entourage.
You know, we wouldn't want something to happen to the Big Green Foot. It's that time again. You've heard there were no groans this time around.
We were just inwardly sighing.
They were silent.
We're too tired to groan. You've heard the theory of 6 degrees of separation, right? Well, it's been 25 years since we opened our water park, Splash and Safari. So let's play a game called 25 degrees of separation. Our eager contestants are given the name of someone or something.
We've only heard this spiel how many times.
And wouldn't you think I have it memorized it by now? I have to read it every time. Someone or something that is connected with the year 1993 and must figure out the connection to us. Now, if you recall last episode, our dear friend, Eric, our dear tattoo-less friend, Eric Rentz, ran the show. And he did send me a note that the last episode's winner, actually, we had a tie. That did not include Lauren. Sorry, Lauren. So Matt, you and I, yay for us.
Yay. I think I was better, but okay.
I was shocked that he was kissing up to you.
You beat up on Eric so much.
Right.
Even if you did perform better, I wouldn't blame him for not
points.
Not giving you the win.
Maybe removed due to abuse.
Yeah. That's why he's really not here today.
He's at a meeting.
Air
and
quotes.
There are no air quotes involved. Not at all. All right, let's try out our sound makers. We'll do our best without Eric here. Okay.
Yeah.
So you got to put on speaker,
I'll go last.
Maybe?
Go ahead.
Are we having technical? The oboe is back.
It's back.
That makes me happy. I have to squeak.
Does not compute.
He's not looking particularly purple in this picture.
I tried to convey it in a photo earlier. And it wasn't really showing up for some reason.
So what color
it's a
did Fies it look?
Photo. What?
What color did it look?
Just kind of like auburn-y.
Auburn-y?
Oh. Yeah.
There's another word.
That's not a word.
Okay. We'll make it work. We have Photoshop.
Try again.
Yeah. We have Photoshop. We could do some really fun stuff.
You can make it whatever color you want.
You could.
After this, we can move me into different light and see if that works.
And then everybody could vote. There wouldn't be time.
Which color should Leah dye her hair next?
It's probably going brown again before I go to India because I'm not sure there.
Oh, yeah.
I'm already going to be a tourist attraction there.
You really are going to be a tourist attraction there.
If I keep the purple hair, it's going to be a little dramatic. So,
yeah.
Good thing.
I'll probably go a little bit more incognito. Yeah.
Like in a few
weeks, I'll be leaving.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, when you guys are recording the podcast, I'll be preparing to.
Head to India.
Leave the country.
Wow. That's exciting.
And then 2 days later, I'll arrive in India. Wow.
Starting in 1991, Holiday World hosted an annual contest, and the winner got married at the park. You remember those? We used to hold weddings. You were all quite young. Thanks. You were here.
Maybe.
That was the year I graduated high school.
Oh, hush now. That was the year I had my second child.
Was he a busta?
He was the Busta.
He was the Busta.
10 pounds, 11 ounces.
I keep thinking of a rapper. Is this like a rapper like Busta Rhymes or something?
Yes.
That's what I keep thinking of. I'm like, you did not have him.
No. I had John. No. Anyways. All right. So we held an annual contest to get married at the park. In 1991, the wedding was held on Raging Rapids. 1992, a couple took the plunge from our bungee tower, which we had for 1 year. What was the venue for our 1993 wedding?
Does not compute.
Okay, Leah.
The Firecracker.
Sorry, no.
Well,
good guess, though.
But I came in first.
Yes, you did. She remembered.
I'm going to go with Frightful Falls.
Oh, dang it.
No, that's not correct.
They took the plunge. Ba-dum-bum.
We already said that about Bungie.
Well, whatever. This works better. Water.
No, reused puns are never as satisfying.
If the first one doesn't Lauren. Work.
The bamboo shoot.
Actually, I'm going to give you a point for that because that was part of it. But the actual wedding ceremony was not held on a ride. Now that you've all taken a guess, the venue that we used was something special that we used just for the day. Matt's putting his phone down. You've heard stories about this. You're going to be mad that you forgot. It was something we did out in the parking lot. Lauren.
Water balloon!
Yes! Oh! Eyes went wild there for a minute.
So how did bamboo shoot tie into it?
Very good. We had a hot air balloon, and actually I've got a news article about it that says
we've talked about.
I think you should get a point for the enthusiasm too. Quite honestly,
that's yes, I think we can put things away now.
You she won. Wins. We're done. Let's go.
You win the month. Holiday World is looking for an engaged couple who would like to get married high above the ground in a giant hot air balloon. Quote. And this isn't just any hot air balloon, said Holiday World and Splash and Safari President Will Cook. This is a 186-foot tall Santa Claus hot air balloon.
Oh. I thought it was Santa, too, but I didn't want to say it as out of fear of being
huge.
Wrong.
It was huge. And in fact, because of windy weather, we had to actually postpone the wedding, which was horrible, having to call that couple early in the morning and just say, I'm sorry, we're going to... And so we moved it, I think,
it's a sign.
A week later. And yeah, it was crazy, crazy. But after their wedding in the basket for the Santa Claus hot air balloon, they then went down the Amazon and we had a sign around the opening because it was the enclosed blue slide that said just married. So they took the plunge as well. So very good.
Well done.
That hot air balloon was wild. And it was still a windy enough day that they waited till the end of the day to actually go aloft. They had the balloon up, but the basket was maybe just 5 feet, 6 feet above the ground. But the balloon itself was wobbling enough. Ooh. And at one point, you know how they actually heat up the air with a big flame, and so they kind of burned part of the balloon.
Ooh.
I remember just thinking, this
I would be getting out.
I
would be getting out.
It wasn't like there were, it was a flame.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, there was a flame that was used to heat the air, but it was more singed, maybe. Ugh. I was just scared. The bride was absolutely gorgeous. I remember when they showed up and I thought, you are both too good looking for this to ever happen again. They were just gorgeous. And she had beautiful long blonde hair and it was on. I thought, oh, I hope you didn't put too much hairspray in that. Cause you could go poof. And she was nervous. It was, it was a nervous morning. It was crazy. It was fun though.
Nice.
It was fun. So good job there, Lauren. All right. Here we go with the second one.
I don't even want to play now.
Yes, you do. You'll get this one, Matt. I'm sure you will. On July 4th, 1993, Alvin and the Chipmunks performed their Rock the Country Jukebox show at Holiday World. Do you remember that?
I do, actually.
We all know Alvin. What are the other... That was really scary. Yes, Lauren.
Simon and Theodore.
Yes, wow.
Do you know the Chipettes?
She did.
No, I don't.
Know the Chipettes.
I'm just going to start taking my own part.
Clearly, you haven't watched the newest Alvin and Chipmunk movie.
No, I have not.
As a father of three children, I've watched them all.
Congrats.
All right, before you take that oboe apart, there is a bonus question.
Oh, no.
Hold what? Up. Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Just okay. Everything's in place.
I'm just going to scream really loudly.
Honk. Honk. All right. Bonus question. What year did the group release its first song, which was actually two songs? What year?
Does not compute.
Matt.
Just taking the read back out.
I'll go with 1946.
That is not correct.
But I rang it first.
Well, this is the bonus, though. You don't get that with the bonus.
I should get two for the bonus.
Yes.
1984.
Yeah. No, these are both good guesses. Yeah, the very sad
squeak. Say it enthusiastically so you get another point. Yeah.
1964.
Not correct. All right, another hint. Matt, you asked me a question as we were walking across the...
Oh, it's the year you were born.
Yes. And you asked, why did you want to know if it was okay to mention the year I was born?
Because I was going to do, when you were talking about holidays, today's also actually like Chinese New Year.
Oh, okay.
So they tell you what animal you are based upon right. What year you were born. Mm-hmm. So I was going to tell everybody what their animal was, but yeah. You didn't tell me.
I know. That's why I didn't tell you, because I didn't want to give you...
Did you think I had looked at your notes and I was going to... That's why I'm laughing. I'm
right now kind of going...
I don't even know how old you are, so...
Do you not?
I don't.
I moan and groan about it enough. All right.
You're comparable to our mother, right?
I know.
I'm older than your parents.
That's what I was thinking.
I'm going to go with 19...
You know, this is a dangerous thing.
I know.
1960.
1958.
Yep, you got it. I'm going to be 60 this
That's
year,
what
which
I
just
thought I
mortifies me. It's just, well, I'll get there, but it's
you're the same age as my oldest sister.
Ah, is she one? Is she the one?
She just turned 59.
Okay.
Yesterday.
Okay. Oh, I saw a very nice picture on. Yeah. Now, is that the one whose doll you...
No, that's, I have
so
not named
her. So this is my sister.
Right. The sister loves me more.
Okay. This one
I just
want
to add,
are.
Though, that I put you 2 years younger. So
thank you
if you want to consider that in the point total, I know I won't beat Lauren, but okay. It's just a moral victory beating Matt, really.
But also,
is what
the
I'm
first
about.
Round of guesses.
You're there.
The first round of guesses, I was the closest.
You were.
So I get any points for pick a number for, you know.
But you went over, so you'll have to go talk to your husband about that if we go by the rules of the...
Stupid Price is Right rules.
All right, we have droned our way to the end of another episode. Please join us again in 2 weeks for episode number 053. And Leah, we look forward to you returning from India and joining us again at some future date.
Yes.
Be interested to see what color your hair is then. We'll just see. Thank you to Stephen Rutherford for making us sound so good and for joining us on the other side of the microphone this morning. And thanks to Josh Moore for keeping things running while Stephen joined us at the table. Josh, I'm absolutely sure you remembered to push the record button. Right. Thanks to all of you for listening. Please subscribe and leave a review for us on, as long as it's a good review. We're really totally into good reviews. That would be so nice. Please. On iTunes, Spotify, Google Play Music, YouTube, etc. And tell all your friends. On behalf of our pod squad, Matt, Eric, Lauren, and Leah.
Hey.
Eric in a meeting. Air quote. No, no air quotes. Really in a meeting, working
actually
hard.
Actually in a meeting.
Yes.
Trying that working hard thing first.
Yeah.
For the first time, you know.
Please be sure to send us your feedback and questions on social media using the hashtag HoWoPo.
You've been listening to the official Holiday World Podcast.
Welcome back. Did you enjoy your flight?
A production of Holiday World and Splash and Safari in Santa Claus, Indiana. Check out the latest episodes at holidayworld.com/podcast. Thanks for taking a ride with us.
And please come back to see us again soon.